Today we are going to learn about income tax, the basic concepts, various terms that are used under income tax, the definitions, their significance as far as our syllabus is concerned, and how these definitions are relevant for understanding the basics of income tax. Now, I'm sure all of you are aware that income tax is a direct tax. That is, the person who pays the tax bears the burden of that tax. Unlike the indirect taxes, where the person paying the tax is merely an agent who collects the tax and pays that to the government. Whereas in the case of a direct tax, the person who pays the tax also bears the burden of that tax. Income tax is one of the finest example of a direct tax. Now, while interpreting any law, such as an Income Tax Act, you must be very clear about the meaning of each word that is used under that particular act. And to highlight, I have written this particular statement which highlights the importance of each term that we are going to use while discussing the provisions of Income Tax Act. The sentence goes as, the income tax is a tax, as I told you just now, it's a direct tax on income. Now, what is meant by income? The general perception of the term income may be something different from what is envisaged under the income tax provisions. Now, when we are talking about the definitions, I must make one point very clear, that there are basically two types of definitions. One is an inclusive definition, whereas other is an exhaustive definition. What is the meaning of inclusive definition? It is one which extends the scope of the term beyond the normally understood meaning of that particular term. For example, income has certain notion in our minds which we normally understand as income. The definition of income under Income Tax Act further extends the scope of the term income, and all such definitions start as income includes. Any definition that starts with this particular expression includes, then that means it is an inclusive definition. And by inclusive definition, what do we mean by it? It means that whatever is normally considered as income, that will be definitely income, but beyond that, even those amounts which may not normally be income will be brought within the scope of the term income under this particular inclusive definition of the term income. So while understanding, it is very necessary to know as to what is the normal meaning of the term income. The normal meaning of the term income is any amount which is received with certain sort of regularity with a definite source. So perhaps you can say that salary is the most glaring example of this, that there is a definite source, there is an employment, there is an employer who pays the salary. Or you may take an example of rent, where there is a tenant and that tenant pays monthly rent. So that is definitely income. You need not incorporate that in the definition, because that is the normally understood meaning of the term income. But then, as I told you just now, the definition will include certain amounts which may not be normally called as income. For example, now I told you that the normal meaning means that there has to be certain sort of regularity. It has to be a periodical return, but sometimes the returns may not be periodical. For example, if an employee has retired from his employer and he has received gratuity, now that is a one-time receipt, it is not a periodical receipt, it is a capital receipt. But nevertheless, under the inclusive definition of the term income, that income is also brought within the scope of the term income. perhaps one of the finest example of a capital receipt, because when we are talking about regularity, we are talking about the revenue receipts. But an irregular receipt, like a profit which you have made on a sale of a capital asset, you have a house property and you have bought it at 5 lakhs and after 10 years you sell it at 50 lakhs, there is a huge profit, but that is a capital receipt. It is a one-time receipt. There is no regularity. But nevertheless, under the inclusive definition of the term income, this receipt will be brought within the scope of the term income. Right? So therefore, what is income? That is to be very well understood in order to properly understand as to which income will be liable to tax. Of course, there are certain exceptions like a gift which you have received. Again, that is a capital receipt. Alright? And this gift cannot be normally called as income. But again, under the inclusive scope, gift up to 50,000 has been exempted. But above that amount, if you receive a gift, that will be again your taxable income. And therefore, we will study this in greater details when we go into the definitions. But right now, what is to be understood is that whatever is normally understood as income, which flows with some sort of regularity from a definite source, that would be definitely income. And besides that, certain capital receipts will be also brought within the scope of the term income. From whom this income will be taxed? Because there will be various entities. As you are very well aware, there are individuals, there are companies, there are various other types of organizations which are incorporated under different laws. So, are they taxable entities? And here, again, there are two terms that you must remember, that earned by a person, but being a person is not sufficient. Who is an assessee? Now, when we are talking about the term person, I told you that there are various kinds of persons. He need not be an individual. Person actually is a classic example of a exhaustive definition. Whatever categories of persons are specified, you cannot add to that category. In the inclusive definition, you can add to the definition. Exhaustive definition, scope of addition is not there. So, in the case of a person, there are categories that are specified, like there is an individual, there is HUF, there is a firm, there is company, there is association of persons or body of individuals, artificial juridical person, and local authority. So, persons are divided into these categories. Actually, beyond this, we can imagine many other organizations, like a cooperative society. Is it a person? The answer is no, because it is not named in the definition. And person is an exhaustive definition. There is no scope of increasing the scope. So cooperative society is not a person, a charitable trust is not a person, and so it will go in the category of AOP and BOI, association of persons or body of individuals. It will be assessed as under that particular category. Having divided all the assessable entities under various heads under the definition of the term person, are all persons liable under Income Tax Act? The answer is no. If I am to represent this pictorially, then I can say that the person is a universe. Whereas a person who is concerned with income tax is a subset of that. And that is an assessee. Alright? Every assessee is concerned with income tax, but every person need not be concerned with income tax. So for example, all of you who are studying now in TY BCom, not having any income, so naturally you are not an assessee. You are only a person, but not an assessee. Then assessee is a person who is concerned with income tax in some way. There are various expressions like he may be liable for determination of his income, or there might be a loss. If he is a businessman, there might be a loss. He may not be having an income, but that loss also should be ascertained so that it can be set off in the next year when he has income. So, assessee is a person whose income is to be determined, or loss is to be determined, or maybe he got some interest from the bank, 50,000 rupees, not taxable, but banks deduct some tax, TDS, tax at source. So he has to claim a refund. So he will have to be filing a return, and then he will be an assessee. So any proceedings, either to determine his income or his loss or tax payable by him or refund that is due to that particular person. So any matters for which any income tax proceedings are initiated or taken, undertaken by that particular person, then that particular person becomes an assessee. Then we talk about assessment. I'm sure all of you are aware that basically when we are talking about income assessment, we are talking about two different laws. The Income Tax Act makes provisions for determination of the income, taxable income, but the tax is levied by the respective finance acts, and it is the combination of these two that is supposed to be undertaken in the process of assessment. The income tax provisions will determine the income or loss of that person, and the tax liability will be determined with reference to the provisions in Finance Act. All of you are aware that we pass budget every year, and in that budget the tax slabs are fixed, and that is the Finance Act which the Parliament passes, and after passing of that, those tax slabs are applicable to various persons as per which the tax liability is determined, and that is the process of assessment. Naturally, that assessment process will take place after completion of the year. The income will have to be determined with reference to some time frame, and that time frame is the previous year. The income earned during the previous year. Now, what is the previous year? Naturally, as you must be aware, that there is a uniform previous year. Earlier, people used to have a choice. I can have, say, for example, calendar year is as my accounting year, or I can have cooperative year, that is July to June as the cooperative year. Various assessment year, accounting years were possible, but later on the Income Tax Act was amended and they said that everybody will have financial year as the accounting year. So every previous year with reference to which the income is to be determined is a financial year, which ends on 31st of March. Obviously, for a business or profession that is set up during a given financial year, say for example, I start a new activity, say in the month of Diwali, November 2016, I have started a new activity. What will be my previous year? It will be the year which will be less than one complete year. It will start with the date on which I have started the activity and end with the immediately following 31st March. So my first previous year will be only of 6 months, starting from the date of starting the business, profession, or the date on which the source of income has come into existence. I have constructed a new property, the rent has started from 1st of November. What will be my first previous year? From 1st of November 2016 to 31st March 2017. So in this time frame, we are to determine the income, and that will be the income for the previous year, which will be assessed in the assessment year. The sources are divided into various headings such as business. What is business? Again, we will have to talk very clearly about that, whether a particular activity can be a business or not, because that will determine which deductions are available. under what head that will be taxed. What is salary? Whether a gift which is given by the employer to their employee, whether it is salary. All such issues we will decide when we go to that particular head of income. House property, we have the concept of annual value, perhaps the only source of income where you may not have any income, but still there will be taxable income. Because you have a property and it is just lying there, doesn't mean that you don't have any taxable income. With reference to annual value, there might be some income which accrues even though actually you have not received anything out of that property. So all these concepts we will learn when we go to the definitions in detail, and this is the course of syllabus which we will be undertaking in the course of income tax.